So today I want to give an example of an extremely painful problem. The kind of problem you never really want to be asked when you're on an exam in particular, because they take a tremendous amount of time. I want to walk you through this painful example because very soon we're going to encounter a theorem that will allow us to bypass the pain and the horror of an example like this one. But to really appreciate it, you need a moment to feel the horror. You need to feel the pain to appreciate the theorem. So let's do an example where we calculate a line integral over a piecewise smooth curve. And a piecewise smooth curve is a curve that you need more than one parameterization to really capture what the curve is doing, because the curve has some sharp corners or some cusps where the behavior of the curve changes abruptly. To give you an example, let's take this exercise, and this is all that we'll be doing today. We have a vector field capital F of x comma y, which is given by negative y comma x. And let's let the curve C be the boundary of the unit square, or I should say the boundary of the size 2 square, negative 1 to 1 in both the x and y directions, which is being traversed with the counterclockwise orientation. Find the line integral of f of xy over the curve C. All right, now the first thing that I'm going to check, is f conservative? Now you see, if f is conservative, this problem is over right away. Because if I have a look at this curve C, the boundary of the square from negative 1 to 1, C is closed. This is a closed curve which stops and ends at the same location. It forms a closed loop. So that if f is conservative, then we know from the theorems of the previous 2 days, the line integral over C will be zero automatically because we have a closed curve. So let's check if F is conservative. Now, this is a very nice vector field with nice continuous partials. Its domain is R2. So let's go ahead and let's check the mixed partials. Let's check partial P, partial Y, the derivative of negative y with respect to y, result negative 1. And then let's check partial q partial x, but unfortunately that's equal to positive 1. So these are not equal, and so f is not a conservative vector field. Conservative. Which is a darn shame, because if it were conservative, this question would be over already, and I would be off playing Stardew Valley instead of working this problem. But this question is not over, and we have a long way to go, because that means that we are going to have to calculate this line integral manually. Now, to calculate the line integral manually, we need parameterization for C. But even that is going to be a challenge, because the behavior of the movement around the square changes rather dramatically at these four corner points. And whenever you see a corner or a sharp cusp on a graph, that indicates that we are going to have to change the function that we're using to represent that portion of the curve. We're going to need one parameterization for the movement on the right side of the square, another parameterization for the movement on the left side, another for the movement on the other side, and then another for the movement on the bottom side. We're going to need 4 parameterizations in total, taking us from one corner point to the other. So we have 1, 1, we have the corner minus 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1, and the corner, positive 1, minus 1. Okay, so let's consider the parameterization R1. R1, which is a straight line, from the point 1, minus 1, to the point 1, plus 1. Now, I encourage you to just take the first parameterization that comes to mind. This question is already very lengthy. The x-coordinate is constant at 1 throughout the entire journey. And to find the y-coordinate, if we start at negative 1 and then add t to it, and we let t go from 0 up to 2, then when t is 0, it positions us down at the point where y is minus 1, and when t goes to 2, it positions us at the point where y is equal to positive 1. So that's fine, and that parameterization will do just fine. There are other parameterizations, but as long as they take you in a straight line from one point to another, all parameterizations will be fine. Now, straight line number 2. The straight line from the point 1, comma 1 to the upper left corner at negative 1, comma 1. So this time, the y-coordinate is constant at 1, and the x-coordinate is going from 1 and decreasing steadily toward minus 1. So if I take this parameterization from 0 to 2, then when t is 0, we are indeed at the upper right corner, and when t is 2, we are indeed at the bottom, the upper left corner of the square. All right, the next leg of the journey, R3. Now, R3 is the line from negative 1, 1, down to negative 1, negative 1. So, in this case, the x-coordinate is constant at minus 1, and the y-coordinate starts at 1 and decreases toward minus 1. So this is the first parameterization that occurs to me that would do that job. When t is 0, we're up at plus 1 in the y direction, and when t is 2, we're down at minus 1 in the y direction. And finally, with the fourth leg of the journey, this is the line from negative 1, negative 1, to the bottom right corner, or back to where we started. So this would be at the point 1, minus 1. And in R4, parameterization number 4, this time the y constant is constant at minus 1, and the x value is increasing steadily from negative 1, increasing toward positive 1. All right. So we now have four parameterizations corresponding to these four different behaviors that are changing abruptly as we move around the edges of this square. So now the time has come to calculate the four line integrals that correspond to these different pieces, recalling that our vector field is negative yx. Integral 1. Alright, so recall that if you want to calculate a line integral, what we have to do is integrate from start to finish the function where the x of the parameterization is plugged in, the y of the parameterization is plugged in, and then you take the dot product with the velocity vector of the parameterization. So we're going to have to do that four times, starting with parameterization number 1. And let's recall that parameterization number 1 had an x-coordinate of 1 and a y-coordinate of minus 1 plus t. So, if I calculate r1 prime, I get 0, 1. And if I plug in these two coordinates to the vector field, f of x of t, y of t for this first leg, will be negative y, so plus 1 minus t, positive x is the definition of the vector field. Remember, our vector field took the input x, y, and put negative y in the lead and x in the back. Okay, so now let's take the dot product, where we have f of x, y, dot product r1 prime. So this vector dotted with this vector, 0, 1, dot 1 minus t, 1, result 1 from the dot product. And finally, for integral number 1, we're going to integrate from 0 to 2. The result of that dot product with respect to t. And so integral number 1 has result 2. Ooh, I feel tired already. And we've only done 1 out of 4. Thank goodness we have a theorem coming soon that will save us this hassle. Integral number 2. Integral number 2. Now, for integral number 2, let's recall that our parameterization was 1 minus t, 1. 1 minus t, 1. R2 prime is equal to negative 1, 0. And if I plug in 1 minus t, 1, to f, the result of that will be the vector which has negative 1 in its first component and positive x, 1 minus t, in its second component. So if I take the dot product, negative 1, 1 minus t, with the velocity vector, negative 1, 0, the result of that is again positive 1. And so we're integrating from 0 to 2, positive 1, result 2. Ah, interesting. All right, that's integral number 2. Now it's time for integral number 3. For integral number 3, let's recall that our parameterization was negative 1 in the x component, and 1 minus t in the y component. R3 was negative 1, 1 minus t, whose velocity vector was 0, negative 1. And if I calculate the value of the vector field along the curve, negative 1, 1 minus t, and get the opposite of the y component, t minus 1, and I get the x component, minus 1. So if I take the dot product, oh, look at this. Look what we get. The dot product is 1, and we integrate from 0 to 2, and we get 2. Okay. And finally, integral number 4. And let's recall that the fourth parameterization was negative 1 plus t, negative 1. Whose velocity vector is r4 prime of t, which is equal to positive 1, 0. If you plug that into the vector field, we get from the inputs, the x component becomes, what do we get? Negative y, 1 here, and then the x component moves to the back. And then we take the dot product. Now we get 1, 0, dot product 1, comma negative 1 plus t, result 1. And we integrate 1 from 0 to 2, result 2. Okay, so putting together the results of the line integrals from all four pieces, we finally get to make the conclusion that the integral of f over the entire square's boundary can be found by taking the line integral over the right side plus the line integral over the top plus the line integral over the left plus the line integral over the bottom. Result, 8 units. Okay, now this was a grievously long exercise, wasn't it? It spanned 2 full pages of work, but consider how simple this problem actually is. Unfortunately, we have a very simple region consisting just of a square and an extremely simple vector field, just negative y in the x component and just x in the y component. So this is probably one of the simplest examples of a line integral over a piecewise smooth boundary where you have to break the curve down into pieces. But what we will see tomorrow is an example of a theorem called Green's theorem that allows us to take integrals such as this one and translate them from line integrals into the double integrals that we used in chapter 12. That will give us a way to calculate these much more easily. And so you get the opportunity in today's concept check to experience some similar agony with a 3-part curve instead of a 4-part curve, and then tomorrow we'll get to introduce Green's theorem.